Hello everyone, my name is Grayson Johnston. I am a senior at Jackson Senior High School in Jackson, Missouri, and today I will be presenting my findings on the effects of the presence or absence of isopods of the genus Porcelio on soil nutrient content and plant growth. So I will be going through what I found in keeping isopods in a particular kind of soil and how it affected what kind of nutrients were in it as opposed to a control and a standard. But before we get into that, what in the world is an isopod? Well, an isopod is any arthropod of the order Isopoda. Within this, there is the suborder Onycidea. This contains most of our terrestrial isopods. As arthropods, isopods have jointed appendages and some sort of segmented bodies, although the chitinous exoskeleton is really only in the shell-like formation on the back. Their undersides are actually rather soft. And then as far as their diet, this is very important for this particular experiment. Some are parasites, but they pretty much live exclusively in the deep sea. The only ones we know of on land, and most aquatic isopods as well, are detritivores feeding on dead and decaying plant and animal matter, which is particularly important for why they are helpful here. So let's go ahead and look at what species we were using here. So I have Porcelio scaber. These are common rough wood lice or the rough isopod. Now, they're lice, about like water fleas are fleas, but they are, of course, a detritivorous isopod. They're generally found towards the surface, top 5 to 6 centimeters of substrate. They're native to almost all of Europe, but they've been introduced nearly globally. Over here, we have Porcelio dilatatus. This is commonly referred to as the giant canyon isopod. They're a little more localized within Europe, usually staying closer into the Northwest a little bit, but they do dip down some into Italy, and they have been introduced into North America, though not almost globally, like the Porcelio scabers have. So here we have tropical white springtails. They are an insect-like detritivore. They are not insects. They do have a somewhat chitinous and hard exoskeleton, which insects do not have. Insects are soft-bodied. However, they look a lot like insects, and they are very effective detritivores. They were included because generally when you buy a culture of isopods, you're going to get springtails with them, and they were just an extra beneficial factor in those tubs. So the plants I used are the common domesticated radish, also called Rafanus sativus, and it's crisp root vegetable. You've probably seen them at the supermarket before, I would assume. And they're very popular in the United States, largely because they are generally easy to cultivate. And then over here we have wheatgrass. It's actually a common wheat plant, Triticum aestivum. And this is just the seedling or sprout version of common wheat. It is often considered a superfood, very high in vitamins and nutrients. But the reason it was very useful here is because it is extremely fast growing, and so it was easy to test the difference in growth between the different tubs. So for care, I would spray the isopods every single morning that we were in school, and then on Friday afternoons I would give them a heavy misting, and that was when it was just them and the springtails. When I introduced the plants, I noticed they were having some trouble getting water or enough water, so I upgraded to 2 mistings per day, Friday afternoon still being particularly heavy. Expected breaks, I would take them home and spray them once daily and then twice daily after the plants were added, or that will come later. I have yet to have any expected breaks since the plants were added. Unexpected breaks, we would get up here and spray them whenever possible and always give them a heavy misting in case I could not get back up here again. So for the next hearing is the problem. What is the problem I'm trying to solve? We're raising isopods, but why? Well, there is a major problem coming out of our agricultural industry right now that is called nitrogen contamination. You'll often see it referred to alongside other issues such as phosphorus contamination in one big giant group called nutrient contamination. And essentially what this is, it's an overflow of plant beneficial nutrients into our waterways. And when that happens, it produces massive algal blooms that can choke out farther down aquatic plants and reduce the amount of oxygen available to aquatic life, which greatly decreases overall water quality and survivability in that water. Nitrogen specifically is extremely potent at causing this, and what we see it from are nitrogenous waste fertilizers, both synthetic and organic. So my hypothesis that I took before this experiment was that Porcellia scaber and Porcellia dilatatus would both perform similarly to potting soil and far above the control in terms of nutrient content and plant growth. And I also predicted that the Porcellia scaber and Porcellia dilatatus would produce those effects at different strata. That is why, as you'll see later, I took measurements from different depths, because since the Porcellia dilatatus tend to hang down lower and the Porcellia scaber at the top, I made a hypothesis that it would most likely be in different areas of the soil. But we can see that the data ended up different. So only 13 of the, actually 12 of the 40 wheatgrass plants that I planted actually sprouted. Now, I have a few different predominant ideas about why this may have happened in these two. This one had pretty good growth. You can see, aside from that outlier 13.7, for the most part, they were quite similar in growth. The averages are only a couple centimeters apart. And so in terms of how they grew, they actually grew quite well in Porcellia scaber and potting soil. They did not grow at all in Porcellia dilatatus or the control. That could be due to a number of factors, but it is certainly an interesting outcome, considering I expected these two and this one to perform almost identically, whereas this one would be about like it is potentially. And then we have a graph which shows the same information. We have our averages, and of course these are not applicable. So this was some of my qualitative and quantitative data that I wrote down in my lab data collection. So we had no growth out of Porcellia dilatatus and the control. I did talk to some of my friends and some fellow science fair participants, and they were more into kind of agriculture and keeping plants. They said this was not the greatest soil, because what I researched for was the best soil to keep isopods on. And so were this to be balanced out kind of halfway point between the isopods and the plants, perhaps they could both live well together. And then this one, I am going with the assumption that most likely it was either the same cause as this, or they ate the seeds or the sprouts right as they came up, because it could very easily be the same cause as the control, or it could be that they just simply ate them, since they do come to the surface every now and then despite hanging out lower. Mostly, as you can see, far better results in the potting soil, but no results to scoff at in Porcellia scaber. So far, Porcellia scaber in this data seems to be the most reliable one to consider. We have our radishes. These produced much more usable results because I had some growth in every single tub. And the radishes didn't grow very well. They actually never made it out of the microgreen or sprout phase. But I got the first tellings of some true leaves in the control and potting soil. Grew surprisingly well in the control, considering I got no sprouting out of the wheatgrass in that one. But Porcellia dilatatus, again, consistently performing at a very low level. So it seems Porcellia scaber is the only even potential option here. And we move on to our nutrient data. Everything was low for nitrogen. I did take this after I had run both rounds of plant tests. So this is very likely because the plants simply used up most of the nitrogen. Interestingly though, this does show that potting soil does not hold its nutrients for very long, given that the nitrogen was already low after just two rounds of very small plants. Potassium was high in all of them, but higher in the Porcellia scaber and the potting soil. And phosphorus was low. There was a medium subsurface in Porcellia dilatatus and in Porcellia scaber and in both of the potting soils, suggesting that there may have been some addition of phosphorus into the soil from the isopods eating up the detritus they were given. So here we have, again, the same information on a graph. You can see where it was medium, where it was low. And then these big spikes in potassium, these were actually off the scale that it could possibly measure with the test kit I was using. So I did have some confounding variables. First one was very likely beneficial, a white fungus or mold on the soil. It kind of grew attached to the little pieces of soil. And this seems to be a colony of detritivorous microorganisms, so serving the same purpose as the isopods and the springtails in fertilizing the soil. Definitely helpful overall, did not seem to impact the plants in any negative way. These could be beneficial or harmful. These are fungus gnats, and they invaded all three of my original containers and started to invade into my potting soil container as well. They can be beneficial in breaking down more detritus, again, but also the larvae can feed on plant roots and sometimes deprive the isopods of food or deprive the plants of food, or as it says here, directly eating up the plants, messing with the results significantly. So my main resources for the information on nitrogen contamination, it was mostly from the Environmental Protection Agency. I got a lot of my information on the crops and how they should grow from the United States Department of Agriculture. And then these are kind of general categories. I spoke to several teams with online stores, such as Josh's Frogs, probably being the most helpful of them. And then I spoke with some other isopod keepers and breeders, such as the breeder that I bought the isopods from when I went to a reptile expo, and also other people who have kept them and bred them, so I knew how to care for them, what they might need, and I was able to pick out plants that would go along with it for the most part. So not the most successful in that I did not really get anything close to what I was hoping for or predicting, but that Porcellio scaber data, to me at least, shows some serious promise with a few tweaks and considerations for future experimentation. This could certainly be, if not an extraordinarily viable option, a local option for individual smaller operations where extremely high output is not quite as important, or were it to be tested enough, it could potentially completely change how we think about fertilizing our soil and what we need to do to fertilize our soil, and maybe, just maybe, even almost entirely do away with nitrogenous waste fertilizers and synthetic fertilizers entirely. That would be a long way off, and this is certainly far from conclusive evidence, but I think the data here could be a very good start towards an entirely different future of agriculture. So thank you for watching this video. Goodbye.